To be big.
I am big. It's the pictures that got small. Turn around, darling. Let me dry you. Teach your friends some manners. Tell him without me, he wouldn't have any job. Because without me, there wouldn't be any Paramount Studio.
You're right, Miss Desmond.
Go on, Max.
So this is another in the continuing commentaries, additional analysis for the American Cinema course. I admit that I'm a fan of this film and also of Billy Wilder, and I'm eternally grateful this work isn't lost. Wilder's work is pretty well represented in most of the AFI's top 100 lists. Wilder was called the Viennese Pixie. He emigrated from Germany, but his parents remained and were victims of the Holocaust. The legend goes that Wilder arrived in New York City with little English and within a few years was writing for Hollywood.
It's the pictures that got small.
He was one of the few to come out of the writing ranks. He wrote 71 films.
Turn around,
to go on to direct 27 others.
Teach your friends some manners.
And partnered with Charles Bracken, a Harvard grad whose family was said to have come over on the Mayflower.
Go on, Max.
A very distinguished gentleman, Wilder was considered the more profane of the two. Wilder had range and directed comedies like The Apartment in the early 60s, as well as dramas and other noir films like Ace and Hole. He and Charles Bracken split after Sunset Boulevard. And at the end of Wilder's career, he had trouble finding work, ironically much like Norma Desmond in Sunset Boulevard. So Wilder's choices here are considered quite bold. This is often called Hollywood's best film about Hollywood's worst.
Los Angeles, California.
The film has many narrative conventions of noir. It was a modern mystery, as it was structured, about some pretty dark subject matter, scandalous even, the forbidden affair of an older woman with a younger man.
You'll read about it in the late editions,
before
sure.
The urban cougar became
you'll
commonplace.
You'll get it over your radio and see it on television. Because an old-time star is involved. One of the biggest. But before you hear it all distorted and blown out of proportion, before those Hollywood columnists get their hands on it, maybe you'd like to hear the facts. The whole truth. If so, you've come to the right party.
You see, the body of the film is intercut and bookended, beginning with Joe Gillis narrating face down in a pool and ending with the same image and story thread. This telling of the tale from the grave, heaven, hell, purgatory of Hollywood's netherworld, adds to the error and confusion of the audience and the narrator who's trying to explain exactly how he got a pool.
Let's go back about 6 months and find the day when it all started.
The film moves on to follow the downward spiral of noir love, a love corrupted by money, decaying like the old pool and tennis court with a sagging net, and it chronicles a sort of diseased relationship of two people who are fated to be together. It is not a romantic tale particularly, but it is realistic, consistent with the noir convention. It makes the viewer uncomfortable when contrasted with the more carefree, uncomplicated relationships of Betty and Artie, at least at the start, and those you see in the romantic and screwball comedies of the era. Fate plays a hand when Gillis, trying to outrun the repo man, has a blowout and finds himself at Norma Desmond's decrepit mansion.
A great big empty garage, just standing there going to waste. If ever there was a place to stash away a limping car with a hot license number. there was another occupant in that garage, an enormous foreign-built automobile. It must have burned up 10 gallons to a mile. It had a 1932 license. I figured that's when the owners had moved out. And I also figured I couldn't go back to my apartment now that those bloodhounds were onto me. The idea was to get to Artie Green's and stay there until I could make that bus for Ohio. Once back in Dayton, I dropped the credit boys a picture postcard telling them where to pick up the jalopy.
We see Joe represented as a sort of forbidden fruit for Norma, where sex becomes decadent and complicated by the jeopardy of his need for a job and her need for what passes for love from a kept man, a gigolo, as it were.
It was like that old woman in Great Expectations, that Miss Havisham in her rotting wedding dress and her torn veil, taking it out on the world because she'd been given the go-by.
You there! Why are you so late? Why have you kept me waiting so long?
In here.
The story highlights the noir idiom's interest in psychiatry, abnormal psychology, and psychiatry, featured in her personality disorders of narcissism and, as they put it in the era, melancholia. The result surveys the reality of desire as perverse, passionate, and ultimately deadly for Gillis.
Have him come up, Max.
Up the stairs.
Suppose you listen to me for just a minute.
Madame is waiting.
For me? Okay.
Do you need any help with the coffin? Call me.
Joe Gillis is struggling to break big in Hollywood. He has minor writing credits, some minor talent, and an agent who's less than diligent in promoting his career. While normally supplied by a detective or a private dick, here Joe supplies the hard-boiled, detached narration typical of the noir or pulp fiction narrative genre. His POV comes across as strong and cynical. It supplies a view of the demimonde or dark underbelly of Hollywood's dream factory and what can go wrong when the waxworks begins to melt and is brutally exposed, a la tabloid style, minus the slick control of the publicity machine managing people's careers and personas. The narrative is terse and quite unsentimental, and Joe's performance matches that tone.
Bright flaming red.
Holden's character wavers only slightly at the midpoint of the story, and his character flaw drives much of the rest of the tragedy.